G'day ladies and gents, and welcome back to War Thunder. With the introduction of patch 2.5, there was an introduction of an extra class, or a revised class of vehicle. Now, I've already spoken about it in a dedicated video of its own, which, despite being fairly negative, is the way I see things, which is, it's just the way it is. So, we're going to sort of put all that aside. And if you want to go and have a look at me sort of having a little bit of a rant, then you can go and check that out. But today we're sort of going to have a look at the plane that, in my opinion, benefits almost the most out of this. Well, one of the planes, one of the props, or turboprops, that benefits from this quite significantly. And this is the Wyvern S4. It is a fairly interesting premium, being one of only two turboprops in the game, and being extremely fast, having its own sort of little niche. Not only that, but being used as a ground attacker is, you know, the most common application of the Wyvern, and for me, I think that that is wrong. I think a lot of people don't really use this plane to its full potential, and we're going to kind of see why. So, fast forwarding a little bit, what I've basically done is pushed myself all the way up the front of the battlefield. I've gone in a fairly shallow climb and still wound up at about 4,000 meters, giving me plenty of room to intercept things like a BB-238. Which is a very, very slow boy indeed. Now, the BV-238 is quite a hunking beast, but it does have a fair amount of guns. So I have to be careful, and of course, being a turboprop, this thing essentially has a jet engine. So once you touch a jet engine, it definitely feels the pain very, very easily. Now, thankfully, there's just some mild superstructure damage there, and nothing particularly serious, but I have to really be careful. Not only that, I've put myself in a bit of a strange situation. Now, I'm not quite playing this plane the way it should be played. I am sort of trying to show you everyone just how far you could push this thing. Now, I don't recommend that you push this thing every match. As you can see, I am 10 plus kilometers away from my nearest teammates. Putting yourself out that far is really not ideal, and what you should be doing is putting yourself into a fairly aggressive climb, or you should also, or you should be climbing out to the side. And this is where you're going to see the most use from the Wyvern. I'm going to show you one game here that is post-patch, and then I'm going to show you something pre-patch to sort of demonstrate a bit of an opinion here. LA5 here, who's appeared out of basically nowhere, he's going for a not really head-on, so I'm going to try and make the most of it. Unfortunately, I can't quite land my shots. Now, I am using stealth belts because only Chads use stealth belts, and yeah, I just felt like surprising my enemies, and I don't really like Hispanos because of the trace around. So I'm going to sort of ditch the trace around and go with stealth. However, I do have a lovely couple of Russians on my backside. Well, the solution is a little bit straightforward, but can be a little bit complicated at the same time. You put your plane in a straight line, and you hope to God that they don't catch you in that said straight line. So what am I going to do here? I'm not going to continue in a straight line. In fact, I'm going to go for this P-47. Now, the P-47, I decided to pick him off because he was basically roughly in front of me, has bombs on, is climbing, and can potentially be a quite serious threat in the right circumstances. So in order to get rid of him, I've just quickly gone in and dispatched of him. Now I have an LA-5, a Yak-9, and another LA-5 to deal with who will appear very shortly. There he is. Now, this first LA-5, I believe, is an LA-5FN. I believe the other one is also an LA-5FN, but you have to realize that these planes are very, very quick. Both of them can very easily hit 500 at sea level, and they're surprising how quick they are. They also climb fairly well, and they turn fairly well. So they're a bit of an all-rounder, sitting at about, I think it's 4.0 or 3.7. These planes are very, very strong. So I basically have to rely on my teammates to polish them off for me. And that's okay, because what I've done here is I've essentially baited these two teammates to, or these two enemies, to sort of follow my C205 teammate. And this has given me the opportunity to either strike back or go and gain some altitude. So what do? I turn, waste some energy, and decide to try and push ahead on with the LA-5, which is really not a wise use of my energy. The LA-5 dips at the last second and then decides to do one of those not-a-head-ons, and I decide to waste even more energy and try and go for a turn fight, which I'm never going to win. This is the kind of shit that I am trying to do to see how far I can push the Wyvern in its new situation. You can see that the LA-5 is basically one turn from absolutely swiping me out of the sky, and there is also an enemy that is sort of looming above me. It turns out it's PE-8, and I shouldn't have worried at all. However, the LA-5 has put himself in a bit of a strange situation. That situation is soon to be basically made null, as I am about to overshoot. I lower my throttle, but it doesn't matter. I am not going to be able to keep with him. So what I do, I push the nose down, gain some separation, and hope to God that the LA-5FN doesn't snipe my ass with 20 mils. You can see I'm not playing well here. This is not how you should be playing Wyvern at all, but the fact that I can get away with it, I think speaks volumes about the play. I'm managing to keep my distance, and of course the LA-5 does not have the luxury of large volumes of ammunition, and at that, large volumes of good ammunition. Unfortunately, the LA-5 only comes with two Shivaks, and being in a situation where you're coming up against P-51s, you are going to have to save that ammunition for a rainy day. And that's kind of what he's done here. He's basically able to push past me, but is now forced into a turn fight by the friendly that is chasing him, and this gives me the opportunity to strike, despite me having really, really bad aim. I don't really know what's going on here with my aim. I think I'm leading way too much, but, you know, if I wasn't haughty enough, if I was humble enough to not run stealth belts, then we would know exactly what's going on. It doesn't matter, though, because there is a P-51 basically chasing this guy's ass, and now we're in a turn fight. There's three of us against one, and it doesn't really matter what I do. I'm able to stay on this guy's six because he's going to have to dodge three of us if we play our cards right. And at this point, both of us, or there are two of us, or three of us turn fighting. I decide to book it out of there and maybe either go and find another target or perhaps go for a re-engage in a later situation. And that's what I think I'm going to do. Literally just putting the nose down, getting a little bit of speed, and looking for a target of opportunity. However, there are a couple of enemies nearby, and they are looking like they would be in an advantageous situation, so I'm not really going to deal with it. Not only that, but it seems like the LA-5 is still going and is still giving the P-47 and the P-51 a hard time, so it looks like I'm just going to have to come in and finish the job. Whether I can aim or not is going to be the key question here. So, as you can see, I'm picking up speed fairly quickly for a prop traveling at this speed, and as you can see, the LA-5 is very, very slow indeed. Looks like he's about to hit the dirt. I put some shots into him, put some more shots into him, and that's kill number three. Pretty fucking simple. The Wyvern can basically get away with murder if you're in the right situations. And if you have teammates around, that makes it even more easy. It's kind of crazy how much you can get away with, and the fact that the Wyvern is just this fast at this lower battle rating, as well as getting an airspawn, is kind of interesting to see. Especially being a strike fighter, it's not really, in theory, geared towards fighting other props or other fighters. It's more geared towards ground attack, so you would expect it to be kind of balanced around ground attack, kind of like the AD4, where I think that's a perfectly balanced plane in Air RB. It has extremely good ground attack capabilities, but against fighters, it has a couple of little aces up its sleeve that you could use if the fighter is dumb enough, but it is not going to be something that you're going to be winning awards with or getting ace games with every game. At 4.3, I think the tables are a little bit on the skewed side here. Definitely, being a dedicated ground attacker, this plane should be balanced like a ground attacker, and honestly, I think 4.3 isn't quite enough. But that's like okay-ish, I guess. We'll see how it goes. I believe that the battle rating changes that should be coming in the next couple of weeks, months, whatever it is, will hopefully address some of these concerns. But like I said, I have voiced my concerns in a previous video, and if you'd like that, you can just have a look at the channel, or if you watch to the end, it might be the one that's recommended to you. Anyway, Yak-9T looking very, very juicy, and of course, because the guns don't quite line up because they're wing-mounted and the convergence is set to 600 meters, I only managed to get a crit on the fuselage, and it looks like the fuel tank, that white smoke or trail of vapor billowing out from the Yak-9T there, looks like it's fuel, and he's looking like he's in a bit of a bad way. So I'm just going to spray a little bit, I set him on fire, and that immediately smokes him out. Very nice kill, actually, considering that he was almost at the same energy level, but I managed to pull through, which, again, I'm not really sure why, I'm not really sure how. Anyway, fast forwarding about, let's say, I think it's about 10 minutes, and there's one guy left who happens to be climbing to space, which is always lovely, always great to see, and looks like there's a BF-109 at 3 kilometers away, and what's he going to do? Is he going to go for the energy fight? If I were him, I would be definitely going for the energy fight here, but instead it looks like he's just going to go for the head-on. So, he's the last guy left. I have 1,200 rounds. I'm just going to spray. You shouldn't do that unless you're absolutely desperate, but it looks like I've managed to damage him enough for him to just bail, and that's game. It's pretty straightforward when your enemies are kind of doing things like that. But that's what you can kind of do against the Germans and the Russians. And now the Germans and the Russians can climb, so they're quite easily the tougher enemy than, say, the Americans and the Japanese. Now the Japanese can climb, but you can outrun most of the Japanese props at that battle rating. And what happens if you're paired with both of them? Well, let's have a look at that now. This is taken pre-patch. This was taken before the update with the airstrike, or the strike fighter spawn rather, and we are in a situation here where I have climbed and I have gone off to the side, and I've only managed to sit at about 3,500 meters. Now the bonus of the American props is because they don't climb, if you catch them early enough they will be in a bit of a shitty situation. Now I've actually put myself in a shitty situation unknowingly. I've got myself a Kai 61 and I'm thinking I'm just going to go for a quick head-on with him and see what comes of it. Pull away at about a kilometer, but it looks like he's going for that, like, not a head-on type thing. Try and go for the next shot, and I managed to get a really nice kill. This is why you don't go for those not a head-ons. You either head-on and then pull away, or you just bug out straight away. You don't sort of fart-ass around and sort of sit around. I would pull away and then go for some sort of defensive flying at the very most. So, we have here a P-51 who is not paying attention. And unfortunately for me, I do not manage to land a single shot until he's basically flying in a straight line. And at that point, I am basically too slow to really do much. You can see a little bit more potato aim there, and my life being potato is kind of a running theme with the Wyvern. Maybe I should be running stealth belts until, of course, I realize that I've absolutely obliterated his plane because all my shells have connected. It's beautiful, isn't it? It's a little bit of a roll of the dice, but it's something that I am kind of willing to take on there. So, moving on a little bit more, we have a lot of enemies that are 3 kilometers or less from me. This P-47 looks like he might be chasing my auto squad mate, and that's something that I need to capitalize on very quickly before all of the other enemies realize that I'm close by enough to shoot down. He's sort of sitting there, looking pretty, basically stalling out. Very, very easy target for me. If I missed that, I would have been very, very embarrassed indeed. And that is 3 very juicy kills on the board. But once again, this leaves me in a bit of a pickle. Now, this PE-8 is probably not going to survive for much longer. He's got a P-47 looking very, very lovingly at him and giving him a lot of his time and care. And now the PE-8 has to go back to the hangar and pay a repair cost. But that's beside the point. I now have 4 enemies on my ass, and it's not looking good. The P-47s are both fast and more maneuverable than me, believe it or not. They are less heavy, which is an absolute miracle, because the P-47, I believe, empty is 3.5 tons, or at least with a little bit of fuel is 3.5 tons, and fully loaded, it's like 8.5 tons. So it is a very, very heavy plane, and this plane is somehow heavier, and I think it has something to do with the jet engine. But regardless, this P-47 is catching me a little bit, and it's kind of scary, because at about 1.1, 1.2 kilometers, they can actually start firing and doing damage. Because for some reason, 50 cals in this game carry a lot further than any other gun. So you have to be really careful about who and what you engage with, because sometimes at certain ranges, you are going to get sniped without really knowing it. Anyway, I'm going to sort of head back towards my team, and all of my team seem to be lawn mowing, but they seem to be doing fairly okay, as you tend to see with the American props. If enemy American props are sort of on the ground, then your team is going to have a very easy time cleaning them up. But if you have several of them at altitude, that's when you start to have issues. So what we're going to do is we're going to put the plane in a slight dive and try and bait the enemies down to low altitude, where things like the Yak-9s can out-accelerate them and out-maneuver them at the same time, giving us a bit of an advantage. So I'm just sort of encouraging them to follow on by bleeding a little bit of speed and sort of trying to get them to look at other juicy targets that might be less hassle than me. And so I can see the Corsair there, and I can see that P-47 who's taken the bait. This is an ideal situation for me, because now that I have the altitude advantage on the Corsair, I can strike the Corsair, but I can also strike the P-47 now. And so that's what I'm going to do. I'm going to keep an eye on that P-47, but I'm not going to go for him. At the same time, I'm going to try and help out my teammate who has that F4U, and at the same time, hopefully the P-47 baits himself for either the J-21 or for myself, and that would be the ideal situation where basically everyone wins, except for the enemy American team, and that's why you don't last minute head on, because you will never get your guns on in time. So, ladies and gents, do be careful when you go head on. I think I need to make an Air RB tutorial where I talk about that sort of stuff, and the P-47 again does one of those not a head on weird things. I don't know what's with it. I genuinely don't know what's with it, but it confuses me every single time. Speaking of confusing me every single time, this P-47 is kind of screwed because he's given away his advantage. And now I need to keep an eye on the other P-47 because he's coming in quite hot. And I don't know who he's going to go for. Is he going to go for the J-21? Is he going to go for me? Now we are all in an energy disadvantage against this particular P-47. And what we need to do is use our numbers advantage to try and thin him out, and maybe someone can go off to the side and climb and catch him when he has less energy than him. That would be the ideal situation, but it looks like it's just going to be the J-21 and myself sort of chasing this guy. Now, I'm thinking maybe I should climb off to the side, maybe I should do something to try and gain some energy, because the Wyvern is ideal when it has an energy advantage, like I've said. But in this case here, it's not really going to work, because he's playing his cards very well, actually. He's not really sacrificing anything, and it looks like I might just have to go up there and do a little bit of risky bisky just to try and get this kill, or at least to try and bait him for someone else. And so we're going to fast forward just a little bit to have a look at what's going on. So we have the P-47 here, and the PE-8 is coming in right below us. Now, one thing that the average War Thunder player really goes for is a big slow hulking bomber. Now, this is a big mistake, because now he's put himself below me, giving him very, very easy access to 20mm gunfire. Not only that, but he has also put himself in the line of fire of the J-21. So, have a look at this dogfight here. I absolutely mess up. I deserve to have died in that spot. But luckily for me, only 4 of his 50 cals converged in the same spot. Now, in this situation here, I should really stop dogfighting. I need to gain speed, and I need to play this like a proper boom and zoomer. I don't have the facilities, big man. Unfortunately, it's just the way it goes. Now, the PE-8 is going up in flames, and the only one really here to help me is the J-21, who's at my altitude with me. It seems like he's decided to go up for a little bit of a climb, and maybe I can bait the P-47 into coming down, maybe committing to a head-on, getting a crit on him, maybe. But I decide to try and bug it out of there. He goes for a weird, not a head-on again. And then what we end up doing is trying to sort of gain a little bit of speed. But unfortunately, he's going for the J-21, which means that I need to strike. This is where I need to make my mark. Otherwise, the J-21 is going to end up dead. But the P-47 jumps off the J-21 and leaves us to sort of fight for another day. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to do the same mistake that I did last time. And, yeah, hopefully try and get some hits. But, unfortunately, no dice. No aim, no brain, just another P-47. No, just another Wyvern main. That's kind of how I feel. Just without aim, without brain. And, unfortunately, the P-47 is taken out by the J-21. Also, the other way around. But, have a look here. I managed to get a couple of little hits, and maybe this is my time to kill. Maybe he's just been damaged so much that it's just time for P-47 to go down. And as I look at my last 12 bullets, I'm thinking, well, shit, that's time for me to make my mark. And he bails out, giving the J-21 the kill. So, you can see that without the Airspawn, you can't afford to play like Monkey. But with Airspawn, you can afford to play like Monkey, even against props that climb better. So for me, I think there's a little issue there. So I'm going to raise a glass of water to the Wyvern and, of course, to its capabilities. Realistically, though, this plane should probably be 4.7 or 5.0 again, just like it was back in the day when it was released with an Airspawn, which is funny because we're, you know, going back in circles. Regardless, the Wyvern is an enjoyably fun plane, and you should really take its potential and use it further. Anyway, ladies and gents, thank you very much for watching. I sincerely appreciate it. I really do. You guys really make my day. Honestly, commenting, liking, everything. Anyway, take care, and I'll catch you next time.